Gentlemen, welcome to the Dota 2 Champions League Season 6. We are in the quarterfinals, the Golden Boys versus the Hellraisers, and yeah, the group stages are gone. No more group stages here, only playoff matches, only best of threes going forward, and only elimination matches almost, because there will be a third place decider match, but there will not be anything else. No lower brackets or any sort, anything like that. That means who loses here is out of the running for good. The same fate that also that already got NiP and as well as Alliance, OG and Empire winning against them in the other quarterfinals that haven't played so far. But hey, Hellraisers versus Golden Boys should promise to be a really, really good match, and I'm really glad to be able to cast it. I'm of course Dragon Drop. I'll be your main cast for the night, and I'm joined for the first time in the history of Dota by Annie. How's it going?
Hey, it's going pretty good. I'm super excited to cast this game. I'm a big Hellraisers fan, so let's see how they do up against the Golden Boys here.
Yeah, I mean, most people would definitely give them the advantage here up against Golden Boys, the Greek squad formerly known as London Conspiracy, especially with this kind of standard that they have right now, Havost playing with them today, along with the Ola Warrior. I'm not entirely sure who that is, but I think I've seen him play with them before. But hey, Golden Boys also with a stand-in Thug. I think I've seen him before. He's also Greek, but I can't really be 100% sure. But hey, well, Hellraisers, no matter if you give them the advantage or not, you cannot count out Golden Boys. I mean, they did beat 4CNL 2-0 to get here. And that's also a match where I would have thought, all right, 4CNL probably got this in the bag. So make no mistake, that's a team that you have to be wary of, especially with the draft already going on. The Tusk as well as the Shadow Fiend banned out. The Doom as well from Golden Boys. So they feel like the nerf is not enough. They banned that out as well as the Wisp. Pick themselves up a Darkseer and an Emberspear. What do you think about that opener here from Golden Boys?
I really like the Darkseer. I think it's one of the strongest offlaners at this point, just because you can totally leave him on his own. You don't need to lane him with someone, so you have a lot more map openness. You can do a tri-lane, you can have a jungler, and the Darkseer, he'll take care of himself. He very rarely takes harass, because you can just run away with the Surge. He has the Ion Shells to give him good farm. I think he's super stable, and obviously a very in-demand pick.
Yep. Absolutely, it gives you that stability and that, also that fallback to be able to just go into the jungle, just be able to farm up in case the lane doesn't really go too well. With the Winter Wyvern, it's always that always has to be in the back of your mind. Winter Wyvern here for Hellraisers, very strong support throughout all stages of the game. Early on with the Arctic Burn, just with that for that harassment potential, even though it's a really long cooldown, it does so much. Also, a really nice escape tool, and then later on, of course, the Winter's Curse is going to be essential to try and lock down an Ember's Bird and the Queen of Pain. Also like that pick, because that's a hero that can go for that quick Orchid, which is something that the Ember's Bird can't really deal with. I mean, any sort of silence, and he's easy pickings, because he really relies on his mobility to actually stay alive. If you take that away in one way or another, Ember's Bird is actually a really, really squishy hero if you can burst through the Flame Guard. So, well, if that Queen of Pain gets off to a good Orchid timing, then Ember Spirit may not get the farm that he needs to go into the later game, of course. Then at some point he will be building either BKB or probably a Lincoln, some sort of defensive item.
All right, Disruptor pick. I really like this here. I think it's fantastic for keeping slippery heroes like the Queen of Pain in place. You have that Glimpse, you have that Kinetic Field, and the Static Storm to silence them down. So, you know, Orchids might be a non-issue here if they need to silence that Queen of Pain very quickly.
Yeah, absolutely. Really good pick for the exact reason that you just said. And just drop down the ultimate Queen of, and Queen of Pain, all of a sudden she can't really do anything. And yeah, similar to the Ember Spirit, if you manage to silence her up, if you manage to lock her down for a little bit, then all of a sudden she's not all that scary anymore. And of course, Disruptor, for the same reason, also really good against Ember Spirit in the first place. So also a little bit of a block pick if Hellraisers were maybe looking at that. Some potential Wombo combo here, Winter Wyvern ult into the Disruptor ultimate. Also very potent, but speaking of potents, Windrunner picked up for Golden Boys, so that'll probably put the Ember in the one position, Windrunner mid, up against the Queen of Pain.
How do you think that's going to fare? I think the Windranger will be able to get off a lot of harass, but Queen of Pain, she has a lot of kill potential if she goes forward, aggressive blink, has that Shadow Strike leveled up. I think this could be a pretty even lane with all these ladies in it.
Yeah, potentially, especially with the Winter Wyvern or with the Undying even rotating around to get that little bit of extra help. Because Windrunner has the advantage of having that 100% evasion with the Windrun. That should keep you safe for the most part. Also against the Queen of Pain. Sure, you can't really dodge a Shadow Strike, but what makes Shadow Strike a really good harassment tool is the slow attached to it, so you can get a couple of extra Reckless in lane as well. That may not necessarily be enough to actually zone out a Windrunner with Bottle Crowing and all that stuff. But yeah, it's as you said, if Hellraisers manage to catch the Windrunner out with no support, then she should be easy pickings there. That's really true. Once Queen of Pain hits level 6, at that point, Windrunner has to be really wary about where her health is at, where the Queen of Pain is, and what kind of mana pool she has available to her.
Absolutely. I think she'll be fantastic for taking towers, but the Windranger, she could also be food. She is pretty squishy if she doesn't have that Windrun available, especially with a Night Stalker. That's going to make her life pretty tricky.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And we were speaking of silence. Nightstalker is one of these heroes that can provide a whole lot of that, which it's kind of crazy sometimes with that what's it called, the Crippling Fear. Max level nighttime, it's 8 seconds of silence.
10 seconds
Absolutely
remaining.
disgusting to play against, especially if you're an Ember Spirit or even a
Five
Windrunner,
seconds remaining.
or even a Darkseer who needs to be able to cast a Surge on himself to just try and run away or at least
Reserve
fight back
time.
with the Vacuum Wall combo. So Hellraiser's looking for early fighting oriented lineup here with the Undying, the Queen of Pain, looking towards the mid game. Right around that second and third nighttime, we will probably see a lot of pressure put on Golden Boys. And I'm not 100% sure if they can actually stand up to that right now.
Yeah, I mean, who's going to be,
Dire
you said Ember
coming
Spear is
back.
probably going to be their position one. I agree with that, but is he going to get enough farm fast enough to contest the really early aggression lineup from Hellraisers?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, that's a question, isn't it? I mean, it's really gonna it's for me, it's also going to depend on the lane.
10 seconds
Right now,
remaining.
it's looking like Nightstalker off lane for Hellraisers, with the Queen of Pain mid,
Five
potentially one
seconds
position low as
remaining.
well. So it's a little bit of flexibility here in HR's lineup, to a point where they could
Reserve
even
time.
go aggro try themselves. I mean, you have an Undying, you have a Winter Wyvern, those aren't the worst supports, even with a Nightstalker, and they could turn on the pressure here onto the Ember Spirit, make sure that he doesn't get anything, and yeah. He doesn't really have too good of a comeback mechanism either. Sure, he can farm with the Flame Card, he can farm a little bit better once he has the Battle Fury, but yeah, as you said,
Radiant
if
team
that is too
victory.
late, if the item timings are too late, then he just won't be able to defend the base if he can't one-shot creep waves with a single Sleight of Fist.
Absolutely. I think Windrunner, she's going to hold herself fine in the early game, but once it gets towards that 15-20 minute, brawl time, Ember Spirit might not be big enough. Hellraisers could just completely snowball themselves into the mid game, into the late game, and maybe take game one pretty easily. But I don't know. It looks like Golden Boys still have their last pick left. What are they 10
looking to pick up
seconds
here?
remaining.
I'm really thinking they need some more meat, some sort of anchor here on
5
team
seconds
fights, but
remaining.
with the support position only open right now,
What about like an
maybe
Ogre
open. Yeah,
Magi?
just thinking that as well. he's one of the more tanky supports that could also fit relatively well in this lineup, I would say. I mean, you have the Bloodlust. It's decent here in this game. Ember Spirit, of
Earth
course, not really
Shaker.
right-clicking too much himself and Windrunner's Focus
Dire
Fire, but it's gonna
team
be the
victory.
Earthshaker. So they're gonna go that teamfight route with a Disruptor, Darkseer, Earthshaker, making a lot of space for Ember Spirit and Windrunner to either farm somewhere else or just do damage in teamfights from a safe distance.
I'm really questioning the Earthshaker pick. I think it'll be fine for, roaming, controlling the lanes, but once it gets down to real team fights, I don't see Hellraisers as a lineup that's gonna, group together in a small circle and allow for $6 million Echo Slams. I think all of 10
Hellraiser's heroes so
seconds
far are heroes
remaining.
that like to position themselves very smart in team fights and don't group up and don't
5
just kind of run into
seconds
the action.
remaining.
So I'm not sure what they're gonna really get out of the Earthshaker, but we'll have to see. Well, there's always the potential
Reserve
for
time
the
granted.
Earthshaker to find some early picks with the help of the Fissure. It's always just the potential to just stop these kind of rotations from Hellraisers just because of that as well, with a good Fissure block. Just giving your carries enough time to get out of trouble. So yeah, it depends on where Golden Boys will be at, the way that they have to play. So whether they have to play defensive or whether they can start taking team fights on back of Hellraisers, maybe overextending. But, well, that last pick, Havos Anti-Mage, so that'll be the one position for sure, and that's one of his signature heroes, hands down. And this turns into a farm war, I would give it to Hellraisers, just on back of that.
I think absolutely. I think Hellraisers, they have the potential just to get more out of the map. I think Golden Boys, they're going to have to play safe, make sure the Ember Spirit always has room to farm, isn't engaging before, the 15-minute mark.
10
Disruptor's going to
seconds
have to babysit
remaining.
him. Darkseer might have some trouble in lane, even though he doesn't usually. I'm
5
favoring
seconds
Hellraisers
remaining.
draft, and I think they have the potential to execute it really well, but Golden Boys aren't going to go down without a fight.
Yep, all right. And with that, we get into the game. If you're just tuning in, welcome. My name is DragonDrop. I'm joined by Annie, also known as Android, here in the D2CL Season 6 quarterfinals between the Golden Boys and the Hellraisers, as the game is paused already. This didn't take long to go bad, but hey, we're just gonna roll with it. It gives us some time to introduce the teams on the side of the Gold Boys here on the radiant part of the map. We've got Skanks playing that Disruptor. He brought the courier with him, not quite sure what that was about. But he's gonna go place an early ward to try and stop any sort of shenanigans coming out from Hellraisers. Still in base, we have Thug standing in here on the Windrunner, Skylark playing the Darkseer, maybe next time looking for the Earthshaker plays, and Kaiser playing that Ember Spirit.
All right, on the side of Hellraisers, we've got Schatzlo playing that offlane Night Stalker. Havost, the big guy himself, going to be standing in on this anti-mage. We've got Afro Ninja on the mid Queen of Pain. Goddamn, going to be on this Undying. And finally, we have Night Stalker, who is not loaded in yet. Or sorry, not Night Stalker. Winter Wyvern, who's not loaded in yet.
Yes,
Oh,
loaded in,
QTP
but yeah.
top. YOLO Warrior, my little game pause thing was over her. She was completely
Yeah.
covered.
But yeah, that's interesting actually to see the teleport up to this particular lane. Normally we see these TPs off to the respective off lanes, but both of these teams just electing to kind of try and mind game each other, expecting exactly that, going for the off lanes, but instead trying to defend their own safe lanes with these kind of teleports. So yeah, laning
What do you
wards here
think
on
of
both safe
this?
lanes. Also nice to have at least.
Yeah, absolutely a luxury, but looks like this ward might be scouted out by Schatzlo. He does not have any sentries to take it down. Undying doesn't either, but look at all the mangoes here in this offlane. There's going to be a lot of harass coming out.
Absolutely. Night Stalker will be looking to spam these spells here in the void. Actually, if you manage to level that up, and with the help of the Undying here, you should be able to get a decent amount of XP until the first nighttime hits. Then, yeah,
30
that's
seconds to
actually a very
battle.
decent nuke to have if you only have that level 2, maybe 1 point in Hunter in a night. And if you're level 4 already at the first nighttime, that's yeah, better than average, I would say, for Night Stalkers these days. But hey, we'll see how these lanes turn out. Looks like a 1-for-1 Runeshade versus gonna see if he can snag the top one for himself. But he has to be very, very careful. We'll probably decide, nope, not gonna have any of it. Wise decision here in
The
my book.
battle
Everyone was here
begins.
for Golden Boys.
Yeah, I think that's just a really smart play, and looks like the runes are going to go 1 for 1, no one gaining a huge advantage. Of course, it would have been fantastic to start the anti-mage out with a little bit more farm, but I'm sure Havost will make it up.
Lanes take shape. We actually have maybe next time hanging around the top here to try and help out Skylark. That's interesting dual lane, but yeah. Maybe it's not a dual lane at all. He will probably just, yeah, probably just for the Fissure here. Just to make sure that the first creep wave will go the way of the Darkseer. And then he'll make his way mid, try to be useful. That's kind of the way we see Earthshakers played these days. Just try and create as much space as you can, and then at some point just try and get your levels. Maybe find a free lane once the rotations start coming in.
Already some really heavy harass up top as Winter Wyvern using that Arctic Burn just to keep Skylark back. I think if there were ever a lane to give a Darkseer a bunch of problem, I think it would be the anti-mage Winter Wyvern.
Denied.
So Skylark is going to have a little bit of trouble staying as close to the wave as he'd like.
Especially anti-mage. I mean, when it comes to melee versus melee matchups, and pretty much one-on-one matchups here, not really counting the Winter Wyvern right now. Darkseer is usually really, really good against these kind of heroes, just because he can spam Iron Shell on the creeps. If you want to last hit, you're gonna take damage. Anti-mage is one of the better heroes to deal with that, once he puts it. Just 1 point into the
Dire's
spell
top
shield, and
tower is
also
under
because of
attack.
the mana burn that he has. He's able to just man fight heroes like Clockwork, heroes like Darkseer, drain some of the mana if they get too close themselves, and yeah, get
Mid
an
lane, there is
advantage
going
that
to
way.
be a lot of damage traded as it looks like Thug is just going to get very, very low,
Is
ticking
he
down to
dying
that
here?
Shadow Strike.
Wow,
Yeah!
hello!
That's Shadow Strike, 2 points, and it really, that was a great distribution. It looks like Afro Ninja securing first blood in the mid lane, coming out as the lead lady here.
Oh, there was a little bit of misplay too from Windrunner. Nice self-cancel here from the Earthshaker there, at least. So Afon and Jay will have to wait for his bottle, which is on the way though, so won't be too sad about it. But yeah, speaking of self, Stark had one. He could have just easily selfed up. Oh, hang on, there's a fight here. Schatzel will get things back just a little bit. It's not nighttime yet, so that will be all she wrote, they say. Skanks nagging the DD rune right out of their hands. Yeah, I think Windrunner could have salved in between the ticks and would have survived there. Maybe just didn't do the math right or something.
Yeah, I think she wasn't estimating or anticipating the 2 points in Shadow Strike as opposed to just going the standard 1-1-1 build that I see a lot. I think that was absolutely the right move, especially against a Windrunner who, if you catch her off guard without her Windrun, you've pretty much secured a kill.
And that's exactly a situation where the Windrun doesn't even help you. I mean, he was standing in the trees, Windrunning, just to make sure not to get any extra damage, thinking it would be enough. But yeah, as I said, 2 points off on the Shadow Strike, really, really good tool if you have as the Queen of Pain, and that's exactly what can win you the lane, especially in this game now already. Alpha Ninja with the first blood, decisive advantage now here.
Absolutely. Up top, we are going to see a lot more harass coming onto Skylark. He's just completely out of regen now. Has the Sol Ring completed, but I mean, Anti-Mage is doing fine, getting all the farm he needs right now, and that can be really, really scary going into the mid game.
Yeah, it is definitely, and it's not like Skylark is doing too bad. He's level 3.5 by about 3.5 minutes. He's right on pace for a good offlaner. Same time though, Sharshan Undying, Sharshan Goddamn here, they're putting on a lot of pressure here. They're intercepting the pole, getting some of the last hits with that, and Skanks has to be really, really, really careful. He's only level 2, has the glimpse, sure, but anything else won't really do a lot unless he can maybe get a good kinetic field off. But
Yeah, I mean,
once it turns nighttime, Skanks has to be super, super careful about just being run down, really.
he's in a really tricky position because he's, the babysitter here, but he's also such easy food, and the more and more he feeds, the stronger that the offlaners are going to get, and the more he needs to protect Kaiser. So, a little bit of a catch-22 here. Kaiser is getting some pretty good farm. He's at 13 last hits right now, so not ideal, but
Try and
he has
go
that
for it
flame
now.
farm.
It is nighttime. Gotham takes a lot of damage from the Flame Guard here. Tombstone is down as well, though. And Kaiser, he's taking a lot of damage. He's kind of locked into place. He will get the kill, but Chachlo might get the counter. He doesn't have enough mana with plenty of tangos. I assume chains and the kinetic field will keep Chachlo in place, though. And now, stuck between the trees and the creeps and the heroes, that'll be two for nothing down on this off bottom lane. Really nice timing from Golden Boys there. Just finding the right angle to fight just when Hellraisers were thinking, all right, now let's start turning the dials, putting on the pressure on ourselves. Not exactly the way that they wanted to start off this first nighttime.
Yeah, absolutely. Like I was thinking in my head, like, oh, nighttime's coming. This is going to be really dangerous for Ember Spirit and Disruptor. And then no, suddenly it was, a double kill, and that's fantastic. That's exactly what they need to get Kaiser farmed up enough to deal with this really aggressive mid lane.
Especially considering that he hasn't really had the amount of last hits that he kind of would have wanted. If you compare that to Vost, was that absolute free farm up in the top lane. He's nowhere near where he needs to be. But then again, Kaiser on the Ember Spirit, that hero has kind of a different curve. He can do more with just a couple of levels than the Anti-Mage could. Anti-Mage is kind of an all or nothing hero. If you have farm, you're great. If you don't, well, why did you pick this hero, right? Ember Spirit, though, if you just get a couple of levels, you can do quite a bit in these early phases of the. In the laning stage in general, and also in the early phases of the mid game, just on the back of your magic damage. If you have that Flame Guard maxed out, if you have the Searing Chains maxed out, that's actually can be really hard to deal with if you get those on the right targets.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the key to anti-mage, ultra simple down is just don't die and get farm, whereas Ember Spirit, it's all about tactical positioning, making sure you get kills at appropriate times. And speaking of getting kills, it looks like the Fissure will be off the mark and not catching out anyone here.
Right now it's only Sharshal here, just getting some extra levels. Still has the mangoes. Has level 5, so he can start rotating around if he wants to. But it's kind of hard as well, because Golden Boys, they're not really playing too far forward. They're sticking to their own jungle, they're sticking to the lanes and to the towers as well. So it can be hard to find an opening without yourself, you're putting yourself in danger as well. Especially up against an Earthshaker with a TP scroll, able to roam around and get the good fissure block off, like in that last fight.
Yeah, we are going to see in the mid lane, Windrunner, she's still keeping herself in this. She only has 19 last hits to the Queen of Pain's 32, or sorry, 33 now, but she has a haste rune in her bottle, and Thug could go in for a kill if she really, really wants to.
To be really, really careful though, because Queen of Pain is level 7, and that ultimate, plus another Scream of Pain, would have probably been close to enough to actually bring Thug down together with the Shadow Strike, so, yeah. Tables can flip as well. As Alpha Ninja decides to just go, he might be able to burst down Thug just in the blink of an eye, really. No pun intended.
And this could be something we're watching out for, although you are going to see maybe next time. Rotating in has the protective fissure if he needs to, but only level 3, no Echo Slam in any near sight.
Oh, Thug tries to go for the play there with the Shackle on range creep. Unfortunately, not quite far enough to lash. I've seen Shackles latch from that distance. It's like really weird sometimes.
That's the siege creep, man. It's always breaking up the plans. Now we are going to see a TP into top. Skylark at full health now. Bringing in Kaiser. They could be going for a kill here. Ion Shell up on the Ember Spirit. Looks like there could be a sleight of fist in the works.
I both gonna try and fight, but no, just says he's two heroes. And just leave Yolowaro to die. Probably wise decision. He couldn't really have done too much there. Last rotation, that's exactly what I was talking about. Not just the Ember Spirit with the Flame Guard and an Ion Shell on top of that. It's so much damage over time just from the hero being there. Some of which you can dispel, some of it which you have to use a lot of magic damage to dispel. And Winter Wyvern doesn't exactly have that burst. Only level 3 himself, only 1 point into the ice shards, so not a whole lot he could have done there. Nice kill, and a glimpse back, plus the rune denies. Gangs might still die for us trying to teleport out, but that is wishful thinking. Yeah, we go. Undying. Goddamn, claiming that lasted just in the nick of time, so starting to get some more action here. And Kaiser actually putting on pressure on the Vos now. He might have some need some help to actually bring down his Ember Spirit and shoot him off the lane. That being said, we've got Yolo Warrior battled by Skylark. He might fall again. There's a Fisher kind of off the mark, though. That's really, really unfortunate. If Yolo Warrior was on the other side there, that would have been yet another easy pickup on that Winter Wyvern.
Really, really aggressive movement in this mid lane here, as goddamn, and Afro Ninja are just going to go in and take the mid farm like there's nothing, and now it's going to be second nighttime. Schlotchlo's here. They want a kill. They're looking to go in on Thug.
Yeah, there's some farm right there. He's running away though, and now the wind run will be spent to Schlotchlo, not quite in range for any sort of slow or silence. Unfortunate, but hey, it's the way it works sometimes. It's gonna happen on the nighttime soon. Top lane though, Kaiser, just battling. He's fine. He has his levels. He can be protected under the Flame Guard. But more heroes are rotating up. We've got Havos battling up against Skylark now, who's out of mana, so can't really do much. Schlotchlo will. Yeah, we'll use that to try and snag to kill himself, but eventually he votes with the delayed mana void. We'll grab that kill, maybe next time unable to stop that from happening. Meanwhile, bottom Skanks, he's too far forward, goodbye. He's glimpsing him back, but it's not going to be enough. Undying, once again, claims the last hit on the Disruptor.
Yeah, I mean, that was a panic glimpse if I've ever seen one, seeing the Queen of Pain and just going like, uh-oh, you know, that's, what, 3-4 hits for the Queen of Pain? She's doing fantastic. She's 1-0-2. She's moving all around the map, getting some pretty good farm. She's top of the net worth
top
chart.
Top lane again. Havos, he's getting chained up. He's taking a lot of damage. Can't blink just yet. He will be kept alive a little bit longer by the Cold Embrace, but the magic burst from Kaiser's Remnants is enough to bring him down at that point with the Wyvern. Also, just food for thought there at this point, and that should also be a tier 1 tower.
Yeah, I don't anticipate any rotation stopping that, but if we look at the net worth chart, the Anti-Mage and the Queen of Pain on the side of Hellraisers are still number 1, so Kaiser, he's doing good, but he hasn't quite caught up with them, and if an Anti-Mage already has this much net worth, that's very, very scary going towards the late game.
Yep. His Battle Fury has been delayed a little bit, but not really by too much. They're gonna need to have another couple of pickups if they really want to make sure that the timing window in the mid game is as large as it possibly can be. If Golden Boys can't do that, and if Hellraisers is able to drag the game out for longer, while also putting on pressure on Kaiser, which is kind of the flip side of the coin, they're gonna have to start using the Queen of Pain as a space creator. And Afro Ninja is. He has the kill and 2 assists, but most of that was the Disruptor, who is pretty much inconsequential right now. Doesn't even have his ultimate,
yeah.
So it's like, yeah, free gold, but hey, not exactly the hero that you want to spend a lot of effort killing.
Yeah, I mean, he's trying so hard. He's actually not last on the net worth chart that goes to Winter Wyvern, but he's pretty much just sitting in this bottom lane, and he could be food at any time with a very aggressive blink from the Queen of Pain. I think even just the Night Stalker and Undying could finish him off with a well-placed Tombstone and Void, so he has to be really, really careful, and I don't think he should be alone. Dire's middle
tower is under attack. All top lane. One here is alone as well, that's for sure. Kaiser and Davos kind of trying to stare through the trees to find each other. But now that will be the mechanism from Skylark here. Haven't really talked about
lane.
That. Oh, what's going on here? Skanks clips back Nightstalker, it looks like. Shasha just turns somewhere else. Kaiser now he's kind of being left alone up top lane. Might be a problem. Does he have a remnant up? That's my question. Yeah, it's back here though. It's not really all that far. And Kaiser? Most will go on him, but the turnaround here, so much damage from the Sleight of Fist, and now the Remnant's in. Aggressively, Kaiser will snag the kill before Afro Ninja can make sure that he will fall eventually. There we go. Took a little bit longer than expected, especially with the DD rune on the Queen of Pain, but It's not exactly the way that Hellraisers expected this to go. They expected Kaiser to just immediately remnant out and then ambush him, but you just turned it around on the Endermage. Only 1 point up in the spell shield is only gonna get you so far there, almost.
Mid lane Thug fighting for his life now. It's gonna take a void to the face, but now it looks like Thug is fine. Thug's just gonna stay here and fight. Has the ultimate available if he gets up to tower.
I really like Sieg Windrunner players these days, just put that early point up into the Focus Fire, ever since it's been buffed. So there has been a time where people just skip that entirely, but it's just really, really good for these rare moments where we have a chain lock on someone to try and burst him down quickly. Or, as I said, for towers, just being able to lay waste as he's doing right now. Chartreuse right here though, with the slow, with the silence, but that haste rune bottled up. I believe the second or third haste rune that he's had this game. We'll make sure that he shall not fall. And Skanks, so he got level
Absolutely.
6 on the bottom lane. He's kind of been left alone too, so that's the point where he can also start contributing in teamfights.
Yeah, he's been pretty much in this bottom lane the entire time, most of the time alone as Kaiser's rotated towards the top. So a solo lane disruptor isn't really expected, and he's having a tough time, 0-2 and 2, but he has the ult now. That's really his key, but it's nighttime and Schatzlo's here, so he has to watch out right now. There's three Hellraisers bottom, and I mean, Disruptor needs to be pinging for his friends madly now.
Well, they have a saw and they're of course smoked up. Looking for a target they may find maybe next time, but maybe not. It's kind of safe here under that tier 1 tower. They could definitely dive it, but it's always kind of a really, really chancy proposition up against Nerfshake. Instead, they're gonna go for the courier here. Nothing on it, but hey. Get what you take what you can get, and they may yet find Disruptor down here in the trees.
Dire's
If he's
top
not
tower
careful.
is under attack.
Yeah, this is such a panic moment from the Disruptor, because what do you
They're
do? Yeah,
looking
you
for
can
him, they
draw
find
your
him as
ultimate.
well. Might be able to glimpse back, goddamn. Actually, turning all around on Tombstone, this is not going to work. Albeit that Disruptor and Charge Lotus punches him down.
Yeah, I mean, that's just such a futile moment because he couldn't even throw out his ultimate there. He got silenced up by the Void. Nightstalker just all over the map.
Oh,
He's
hang on,
doing
mid
exactly
lane.
what he needs to.
Yolo Warrior will fall. Teleport reaction comes in. That'll be Alpha Ninja. But the Echo Storm is there with a follow up stun. Not quite enough, though, to keep him in place for too long. But Kaiser's here, gets his chains off. And that should be that Queen of Pain. It is with the Power Shot coming in as well. And that is not something that Hellraisers wanted to have happened here. They wanted to use the Queen of Pain just to get a counter kill to make sure that she can keep snowballing, get that Orchid up and running, but little delay those stands. Meanwhile, Bob, the tier 1 will fall. The teleports came in. They're gonna go on a Vos again. They do have some vision here, so they can maybe glimpse back. Yes, they can. On range, and that's the ultimate. A Vos, nowhere to go. Maybe next time with a Chainsun. Even the wall committed as Shachlos also joined the party. Kaiser, he'll just make sure that that is yet another kill. Heroes is just falling apart. Goddamn, nothing he can do. But to try and run away, and at this rate, he might not even make it. But hey, no extra mobility here on Golden Boy, so they're just gonna be happy with the two extra kills, one of which on the Anti-Mage down here in the bottom lane. And then that tower push that follows.
Yeah, I mean, that was a fantastic move. Yeah, they lost a tower, but take a look at the team net worth chart. It's now back in Golden Boy's favor. They got the kill on the Anti-Mage and the Night Stalker, two of the most pesky heroes this match so far, and I mean, like I was saying earlier, the key to Anti-Mage is don't die, so every death just sets him farther and farther back.
Yeah. He does have his battle fury now, so at least he's got that going for himself, but actually, if you could do a stack check, they're only now starting it, unless he's already found up some, but there's a double stack here in hard camp and one in the medium camp in their own jungle. The thing is, Anti-Mage, with these deaths, he will need quite some time to actually before he actually gets online, gets relevant in team fights. Until that time comes, Kaiser is with the amount of covering fire that he has from Nerfshaker, from Disruptor, from Darkseer, they can do a whole lot when it comes to five men right now. Golden Boys can, and yeah, they're utilizing that. They're just pushing straight to the tier 2. Don't even give down. Just make sure that the game doesn't go as long as it needs to for the Anti-Mage to flourish.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, what's forcing them back right now? They're scared of nighttime, they're scared of Nightstalker, but they've still got a good amount of daylight left. Looks like the Winter Wyvern coming in, throwing out some scary ice, but I mean, Golden Boys, they're still here to stay. I mean, they're not really afraid of anything. They have a Disruptor ult ready to go. They have a wall if they need it. They even have an Echo Slam in 8 seconds. They have full team fight potential ready to go.
Yep. If they had a smoke as well, they could potentially go for fake back right now. It's just a siege at this point. And Hellraisers, normally you would just either say, alright, we team fight, but they can't really do that right now with the position that they're in. The other thing would be, hey, split push, bit of those. These farmer jungle, these two afraid right now to go to commit to this top lane. And
yeah, I mean, what do you do if you're in Hellraiser situation right now? Do you try to contest this tower? Do you try to just force out the ultimates from Golden Boys and then back? Do you try to just split up elsewhere and farm, which it looks like that's what Anti-Mage is doing and that's what he should be doing? But I mean, I don't know what you do in this position. It seems like Golden Boys are starting to snowball and Hellraisers aren't in the position to take them down.
That's really, that's exactly right, and it's also due to the Nightstalker maybe. I mean, Shardslow hasn't really been able to find any sort of ganks and rotations in these earlier night times that you really need from a Nightstalker to be able to just keep the train going. Just create some space for your team. I mean, that's what it's all about with an Anti-Mage on your team. And Queen of Pain, Alpha Ninja, he's been doing alright. There's only so much that you can do as a Queen of Pain, especially with that Orchid build. And with now Golden Boy's 5-manning, that is not the item that you want to have. You kind of want to have that Agnum Scepter instead, just to be able to clear waves, to be able to do a lot of extra damage. But now, NJ might fall here. Blinks into the trees. Can they find him? Not guessing. Not throwing out the vacuum there. So, Lucky Co-op gets away. But once again, it's Golden Boy's map.
We are going to see a disconnect from the Queen of Pain here. But just something to note is there was a smoke up on the Earthshaker, as well as the Windrunner. They are now in the Dire Jungle, ready to look for some blood here, but they really won't find much of anything, as you know, everyone else is kind of towards the Ancient Pit, and Anti-Mage is all the way down in the bottom lane.
Yeah. Hellraisers, they do have that aggressive ward in the Radiant Side Jungle, and that'll at least spot out that there's nothing really going on down here. Middle lane is also pushed out, no one to be seen there, so it's a good conclusion to make that they're probably in your own jungle. That means that the most can be fairly confident, split pushing down this bottom lane. Fortunately, there's no tier 1 to take, so no extra golden flux that way. But at least he's farming, that's really what Hellraiser's game plan is going to have to be. Try and defend your T2s as best you can, try and defend high ground if it comes to that, and just make sure that the Anti-Mage gets to the point where he just starts picking off people, can't really be killed anymore. And that point will probably come. At the same time though, Ember Spirit, when it comes to late game carries, he's also one of the better ones, if he has like a ridiculous amount of damage items for the Slide of Fist.
Alright, looks like we are going to go ahead and get back into the game. Like you said, Hellraisers right now, they're trying to farm up, maybe defend their tier 2s if it seems right, but it seems like Golden Boys are snowballing, and when do you think that's going to stop? What does Anti-Mage need to get? What does Nightstalker need to get to put a stop to this?
Well, Nightstalker is getting that Aghanim Scepter now, and that'll definitely help just to make sure that you take team fights at an intelligence advantage. But hey, there's a Shackle will not latch, so Shashlo will probably survive. Maybe half an inch or not. He gets locked down with the Static Storm as well. Easy pickings there on what is not the highest net worth hero. Hasn't been for a long time now. Yeah, free pickoff on one of the Hellraiser's cores, and if they keep playing like that, there's really not a whole lot that they can do. They need to have that Axe and Nightstalker, just so these kind of pickoffs just don't happen. They need to have the intelligence advantage, they need to see Golden Boys coming before they get these skip jumps.
It looks like it's going to be another free tower here on the side of Golden Boys. They've now picked off the top and bottom tier 2s. Looks like they could be heading towards the mid, but they did take some damage to their own tier 2 down bottom. Kaiser TPing back to mitigate that, and it looks like, I mean, Anti-Mage and Goddamn are both being forced back here, and that's not the position you want to see your Anti-Mage in at 20 minutes in the game.
Absolutely not. I mean, he's doing okay in terms of farm, 20 minutes in with the Battle Fury and almost has the Vlads completed as well. But if you compare that to where Golden Boys is at now, just in terms of map control, that's only our tier tower left is this tier 2 mid, and that's not long for the world. Once Golden Boys is to group up again, that'll fall as well, and there's not really a whole lot that Hellraisers can do to counter that. I mean, sure, you have a 1 to 5 and ultimate, you have a Queen of Pain, but that is some damage, but where's your follow-up? You don't really have much. Undying Tombstone, it's okay. But you really need that to stack up during the Winter's 5-minute Winter's Curse, almost, it feels like, to be able to get Golden Boys without any collateral damage. And yeah, there's Ganks. That's the Winter's Curse, but he doesn't even immediately die to it. The ultimate has to be committed as well. Thug gets grazed by that, but he will be able to just wind run out, it looks like. Now for Ninja, took quite a bit of damage himself, and That's a really long cooldown ultimate committed just to pick up that disruptor again.
Yeah, absolutely. That was a lot of expense wasted just for this disruptor who, yeah, he has a fantastic ultimate and he can glimpse back a key player, but what else is he really offering? Oh, Havos might be in some trouble here. Does manage to blink away, but might be brought back here. Urshifu going in, catches the long range fissure, and now it looks like he's in trouble. Surge in onto the Windrunner, who decides just to back off and go the other way. So maybe a little bit of miscommunication, but Havos gets off away, but man, he's scared to farm anywhere right now, and that's not where you want to see an anti-mage.
Absolutely. It's really gonna come down to whether they can defend higher ground, and I really got a question if they can. Especially considering Roshan. I mean, it's not really the best Rosh taking lineup, but it's not the worst either. You can kind of spread out the damage, and you have the focus fire to just put on some extra. Even with the Aghanim Stepdown, it's not completed as well, so if they want, they can take Roshan. That'll just make breaking base all the more easier.
Is it just me that just noticed that Undying is not picked up as ultimate yet?
Oh, that's interesting. Oh, Skanks. What are you doing? I mean, I keep saying that he's not really consequential, but giving up deaths like that is not exactly what you can afford anyway. And now it looks like Hellraisers might want to try and go for something more, but they won't find it. Oh, blink out for maybe next time. Just in time, I dare say.
There's
Now
going
to
to be a
smoke up
smoke up from
houses.
the Dire. Looks like they are going to rotate into the Rosh. Maybe. They are going to check out the Rosh, and looks like they are going to take it. Picking up some illusion runes. Hopefully, there was no vision of that from the Radiant. But this was a really nice Rosh opportunity. I think it's one way for Hellraisers to really scrape their way back into the game right now. They need to get that Aegis the Immortal. They need to get that extra gold. It's going to be a really, really good turning point if they get this completely uncontested.
It's a really smart move to try and go for this now. A little bit of an all or nothing play as well, because if they do get contested, the Golden Boys would have smelled this out, and looks like they may now. Grouping up, maybe waiting for smoke. They don't have one. Yeah, there we go. They have one smoke off cooldown on Skank for a couple of seconds, but it's too late. Roshan is already down. If Golden Boys were just a little bit quicker on the trigger there, then that could have ended disastrously for Hellraisers, but right now they have an Aegis on the Anti-Mage. This will probably be a farming Aegis if you've ever seen one, just because they still can't really take fights even with that on the Anti-Mage. But it'll buy them a lot of time, because Golden Boys, as good as they are feeling right now, I don't think they really want to risk going high ground without that extra life.
Yeah, I mean, Golden Boys, they're feeling really good. They've got a lot of map control going for them, but take a look at the net XP chart. It's actually heavily in favor of Hellraisers right now, and I think that's just because you've got the big guys on the team. You've got Anti-Mage, you've got Night Stalker. They're both sitting pretty comfortably in terms of levels.
Also due to the 5-man of Golden Boys, I mean, sure, that you're taking towers, but you're spreading out a lot of experience, whereas Hellraisers, they're spread out across the map. Getting some extra experience, and Skanks will fall yet again. Or maybe not. Skylark actually tries to go for the combo, but the Echo Slam will whiff as well and gets it out. Now three heroes, and now all the ultimates are being all the ultimates are being thrown on. Kaiser joins the party. That's the damage that they were looking for. Shatlo will get cut off by another sleight of fist. Vo's still alive, but he sees the rest of his team dying, and the shackle will trigger the Aegis. 4-for-2 trade so far, and that will probably be another one if they can get the chance. Right there it is. Just throwing out everything on that Anti-Mage as it came back to life, and now
that's a 6-man wipe essentially. And now
essentially, yeah.
Golden Boys, they have the opportunity to go take this mid tower. Anti-Mage isn't up for 50 seconds. Does he have buyback?
Yeah, he does indeed.
He does have
but
buyback, but what can he do at this point? He's not big enough to contest this wall of damage coming out from Golden Boys. We were worried that Kaiser wasn't going to get enough farm or space to himself to get big enough in time, but I think that's certainly changed right now.
There's a glyph available, so that'll delay this a little bit, and the death time is also relatively short at this point, so most of them will be back up. And actually, Anti-Mage, what did he buy? He just bought the Mantis Star recipe, knowing that he won't have to buy back. But even just with that short time, they did so much work on his tier 3. They lose another fight like that, that might be game already. After a nice shackle here from the Centaur, focus fire, will it be enough? They need something more, they need a glimpse back, and they will get it. And can they blink out of time? No, doesn't look like it. At the same time, Winter Wyvern falls. Kaiser's still going strong after goddamn. He's sealing himself up, but it's only going to delay the inevitable triple kill for Skylark of all people.
Yeah, this Darkseer
he just smacks those
absolutely
with the
on
ion
point
shell,
with the
man.
Ion shells. And the walls themselves have been really good. Sometimes maybe a little bit overcommitting and, over securing a kill, but I Skylark has been playing out of his mind right now. Not super, super intense in terms of item build. He has those classic, you know, mech soul blink dagger boots, but he's doing exactly what he needs to in the fights, which is just keeping everyone scared, keeping everyone taking damage from the ion shells, throwing out incredibly well-positioned walls. And do you think Golden Boys have snowballed out of control, or do Hellraisers still have a chance?
Well, I hate to call things early, but at this point, it's a really, really tough spot to be in, because you have a Nightstalker who can only do so much with the kind of start that he had. You have an Undying who naturally falls off in strength at this point. You have a Winter Wyvern who hasn't really been able to find these big Winter Scourges. It's still only level 1, so even if you get it off, it's like 2.5 seconds. It's mediocre at best, because they're also lacking the damage. It's really, really hard right now. Once again, I hate to call it early. If Golden Boys just run in and kind of throw, Hellraisers can still get this game, but I don't see what's stopping them from just going high ground once the next Roshan hits. They will be able to secure that, and then they have all the tools that they need. They have Nerfshaker, who's building a 4-staff now on top of the Blink Dagger, so he's got the mobility. You have a Windrunner with a Blink, plus the Axe, and plenty of gold to start building his the first damage item. You have a Disruptor with everything that he needs. Arcane Boots, plus the Static Storm at the ready. You have a Darkseer who's guarding Grease Blink as well. And you have an Ember Spirit who's not quite sitting on top of the net worth chart, but pretty damn close with the Battle Fury, as well as Mantis Style of his own.
We are going to see Havost going very aggressively here on Kaiser. Looks like there's going to be an Orchid up from the Queen of Pain. It looks like he's going to be taking incredible damage. Havost just hitting, and it looks like finally a Mana Void from Havost is going to finish off the Ember Spirit, and that could be the kill they need.
Well, the Kaiser's Curse, it strikes again. I'm so, so sorry, Kaiser. But hey, that was 4 hero commitment at the same time top lane. Not quite at tier 3 yet, but Stark will be looking to push that out and force them back. So even though they get that really, really nice kill, Hellraisers, it's really hard for them to get any sort of extra advantage off of that. They aren't in position to push an extra tower. Roshan's not up yet. Will be in 6 minutes, so rather long respawn, I believe.
Yeah, it's been a pretty long time. And who do you think is in a better position to go in for this Roshan? Like, do you think this could come down to one final fight in front of the pit, or do you think it's going to be super sneaky, no one knows what's going on? I just think, you know, both teams have the potential to make this Rosh work for them so well.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, Hellraisers does have the Undying plus the Winter Wyvern and the AoE from the Queen of Pain. But if you compare that to these excellent Rosh fighting abilities from Fissure, Echo Slam, and all that AoE lockdown from Earthshaker, you have the Static Storm, you have the Darkseer, just the mass at controlling these kind of teamfights in these tight areas, I would have to give it to Golden Boys if it turns into a 5-on-5 fight. But if Hellraisers can sneak it again, well, then they might be able to delay the game long enough for that Anti-Mage to get where it needs to be, to just blip push it out if need be. Just hold base indefinitely and have the Anti-Mage do the rat work. It's also a way that they can't go, but if it comes to a 5-on-5 teamfight right now with the position that they're in right now, Golden Boys with about a 7.5k gold advantage, give it to them for sure.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned just having Anti-Mage do the rat work and having his team defend high ground, but Hellraisers really don't have that fantastic of a high ground defense. They have the Queen of Pain and they went to Wyvern, and those two are great, but the Undying, he's much more of an offensive, you know, throw the tombstone down and zone people out kind of thing. But after that, you know, he just barely got his ultimate. He's really not doing as good as you'd expect an Undying to do.
Gonna run into Chandler here. Shatra will break the smoke. Skylark with the vacuum into the shackle, into everything. A little bit of overkill maybe on these two heroes. He didn't need all their ultimates there, but hey, take what you can
kill
get.
Secure.
Yeah, exactly. Triple secured, if you will. But hey, that's
yeah, but
two heroes
down.
Yeah.
There's no.
Oh, goddamn, no. No, he was going to fall too. Does have the mechanism to keep him up, drops the tombstone, but the glimpse back. Afanage is gonna try and help. Can put the signs off the maybe next time, but he's already blown his load. He doesn't have the Echo Slam anymore. Doesn't have any sort of contributions to make at this point. And even the ultimate blown to no avail. And if you don't go right now for Golden Boys, then I don't know when.
Yeah, I mean, they feel just really, really hesitant. And in the team fights, they've been throwing out all their ultimates to secure the kills. It feels like they're just, you know, they're a little bit underconfident of where they should be. I feel like Earthshaker, he's holding on to a gem, so he does need to be a little bit more careful of, you know, if he were to go down, where does he die? But I think in this situation, there's, you know, high ground waiting for them.
Radiant's
bottom tower is under
Glyph will be forced out as the backdoor regeneration, the backdoor protection was already lifted by these creeps in mid.
Radiant's bottom tower
so, yeah, right now Golden Boy's just making sure that all the waves are pushed out, because actually if you look at bottom lane, both presumably has been doing some work. Tier 3 down.
He was doing that rat work that you were talking about, but then again, you know, they lost a couple in the mid lane. I feel like Havost, he almost needs to be fighting with his team, and that's never where you want to see an anti-mage, but he's just really... He's making up the farm he needs to. He's top of the net worth chart, but what's he going to get out of that if his racks go down?
Well, it's not like he really has bad items for team fighting right now. It's kind of the sheer minimum that you have to have, like mana style for defensive purposes, battlefield for some extra damage and cleave. And and the VATs that can actually help quite nicely in team fight. It's not just yourself but the rest of your team. But once again, as you said, we'd rather have him split push. And there we go. He's doing exactly that. Top tier 2 is in peril. Kaiser looking to try and do something against this, and will at least stop this push. At the same time, it's not going to be there for that Roche attempt.
Roche still has a good long time to go, and we are going to see a rotation in just from Kaiser. He is just going to do what he can. Earthshaker putting down the Gem of Truesight is gonna make some space for himself. They're all smoked up here, Earthshaker's just invised up, but what do they do with this? It feels like Golden Boys, they've had the map handed to them and they just haven't been able to take what they need. They have the, you know, mid racks and that's fantastic, but it feels like their window might be closing just a little bit as the anti-mage is just gonna get bigger and Night Stalker's gonna get bigger. What do Golden Boys do to secure this victory?
Well, once again, it can come down to the Roche. It's probably what they're waiting for. Anything else would kind of not really make sense. I mean, they have pretty much all the items that they need at this point. So that's the only thing that I can think of that would actually keep them from going all aggro. They even got the gem from the Night Stalker. We haven't really pointed it out particularly, but the gem that the Disruptor was carrying, or is carrying here, was actually on Goddamn before. So you still have that unobstructed vision during nighttime, but you don't have the true sight to go with that. I just think it'll be the next Roshan, and then Golden Boys will try and go for high ground. At the same time, want to make sure that these side lanes aren't pushed out are pushed out long enough so that Dantamage can't immediately trade for Rax.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Golden Boys are in a tricky situation because they've got incredible team fight, but now Hellraisers have kind of figured it out. They're splintering off. They're not all being in one place, and that's where it's getting tough. Here we go. There's another nighttime, and this could get kind of ugly as we are going to see Darkseer get pretty close to the Night Stalker, but no, he will blink himself away and run as fast as he can.
Charger just scouting out Roshan. Hellraisers. Oh, well, it's going in mid. There's a Shackle onto a tree. Havos will be locked down with the Echo Slam. That was a worthy trade here. Wasn't even trade. Yeah, you can call it a trade, I guess. Ultimate for a hero. That was the 17, almost 18k net worth Anti-Mage. It does not have buyback. If Golden Boys catch wind of that, then that should be at least one more set of racks. Side lane, bottom lane is pushed out quite far enough. Top lane is almost at the tier 3. Can Hellraisers defend this right now? They don't have Glyph, they have Winter's Curse, but they don't have their Anti-Mage.
Yeah, who's their target in this? Are they going to immediately go for Kaiser, or are they going to go in for Thug, who's just melting down these towers and racks like it's nothing? It feels like there's almost too many targets right now because of this Ultra Team fight lineup. It looks like there is going to be a Tombstone thrown down. It looks like the ultimate is going to be popped from the Winter Wyvern onto Kaiser. Kaiser just remnants back. He's doing okay right now. Thug just going in for these racks, doing what he can. And YOLO Warrior, what do you do as a Winter Wyvern against a lineup like this? This just feels horrible. Looks like Queen of Pain has her ult, but who's she going to pitch it onto? Looks like Orchid is going to go onto Kaiser, but he immediately just mantas it off. And now Afo Ninja, he's just sitting here like a duck. He's getting stuck in. Looks like there's going to be a glimpse in from Goddamn into a beautiful wall and Static Storm. This could be it, and it looks like this may be it for Hellraisers, that they're going to get completely wiped, and now there's going to be some free racks handed out to Golden Boys, and this is looking more and more grim for Hellraisers. Anti-Mage, he's back up, but what does he do?
Well, they're going to throw it in for one last ditch effort. I have always kind of already wasted a lot of time on this BKB. Maybe next time just blinking out. Everyone just dodging him. Alpha Ninja as well. He's got to slow off an illusion. It's just like, ah.
Yeah, this game is over already. At this point.
But I just want to point out again how beautiful that team fight was. So that's their entire high ground push from Golden Boys. They're not overconfident. They have the Windrunner just taking care of the buildings. They have Kaiser on the other side of the racks, just zoning them out, just looking for opportunities, and the rest of the team and the back with the blinks ready to just jump in at any time. And that's exactly what they did. I mean, they weren't, they were never really in a good position for Winter's Curse that hits more than one target. I mean, as soon as the Yoda Warriors was throwing that out, it didn't even have enough fallout for Kaiser there, right? And, oh wow, they will find two more here. Vacuum into the chains, Kaiser's just chopping away at them. There'll be half an engine at least blinking out for the time being, Evos falling one sealed, but there's a glimpse back, that'll be goddamn. That Undying will be dying right now with the shackle onto the trees. Easy pickings. Doom Heroes down, and don't really see them surviving this one. Shacho? Yeah, everyone's on top of them. Queen of Pain drops the ultimate. They will get the disruptor, but hey, Echo Slam, Shackle. Havos gets another kill just for the. What's it called? I forgot the word what it was going to use, but hey. Well, Sim going down at the end of it all. Kaiser will snag that kill. The Battle of the Carries, and the GG well played is called. Golden Boys take game number one in this best of three series. Yeah. What a good execution from them.
Yeah, that was certainly interesting. The draft was, you know, we thought it could go either way, and then looks like Golden Boys, they found their lead and they held on to it, and they were very slow. I thought they could have, you know, sieged faster and snowballed harder, but I guess slow and steady wins the race. They did what they needed, and Golden Boys have game number one in this best of three, so we're going to move on to game two very shortly.
Oh yeah, and yeah, so we're talking about the draft. Do not count out Golden Boys. That's a really, really nice squad. And Disruptor, come on, Skanks. He's trolling as well. He bought four mangoes at the end of it all. But hey, just to mess up the endgame stats for the for that Dota, I guess. But hey, yeah, we'll be right back with game number two, so don't go too far away.